Okay, a very good morning to all of you. And today we will have an overview of the solar system. We will not get into very great details, but we will look at the gross constituents and we'll pick up a few questions along the way and try to answer them. Now, first, I would like you to start off by asking you, any one of you can unmute yourself and can you describe this picture, what you see? Any one of you.
The moon in its crescent phase.
The moon and?
The moon in its crescent phase.
Okay, the moon in its crescent state. A little bit more than that?
An eclipse?
No, it's not an eclipse. A little bit more than that? Anybody?
So, Earth shadow is casting on the moon.
Not shadow casting on the moon. Okay. What you're seeing is a bit of a crescent
it's
moon.
It's a waxing crescent, not a waning.
Sorry, Ekta?
Is it a waxing crescent?
It's a crescent, but there is something more about the moon.
I said it's not, it's a waxing crescent, it's not a waning moon. It looks like.
Okay. What I wanted the answer was that, you see, normally when there is, when you see the moon on usual occasions, most of the time, you see the crescent, right? Very clearly, but you don't see much of the rest of the moon. But what you're seeing is, here is the rest of the moon is also, is not as bright, obviously, but it is reasonably clearly seen against the background. And the reason why that happens is as follows, okay? In fact, this is something which has been noted for quite a long time. And one can see, I just picked up one of the Scottish maritime ballads, which are songs which the sailors would sing, called Sir Patrick Spens. And he described, or this ballad describes, he says, yestreen I saw the new moon with the old moon in her arm. I mean, it looks as though, you know, this crescent moon is holding the rest of the moon in its arms. And I fear my master dear that we will come to harm. I mean, anything which is unusual in the skies, they thought of it as forebearers of doom and disaster, right? But what you're seeing over here is actually what is called earthshine. Earthshine is where sunlight which gets reflected from the earth to the moon and back again. This was actually taken by a photographer, a German photographer, in Ottobeuren in Germany. And this is best seen when the moon is, you know, about 3 days old, you know, after the new moon or just before new moon. And where's the optimum time to discern earthshine? As I say, it says most easily visible few nights before or after new moon. And an explanation of this was actually found in Leonardo da Vinci's notes, which were written between 1506 and 1510, a common era. The oceans reflect the least amount of light, about 10%, land a bit more, and the clouds reflect about 50% of the light. So how much of light gets reflected and how much of what is called earthshine, which you see, depends on the cloud cover as well. So the average is somewhere around, you know, mid-30s% or so. But earthshine has also been used to monitor long-term cloud coverage. And long-term cloud coverage is also implications for climate change. And it is something which we need to monitor as closely as possible. So earthshine is something which is which you see when the moon also reflects back sunlight from the earth. Okay. And do you think you can see it in any other planets as well? We know of planets and many other moons in many other planets as well. So do you think you'd be able to see a planet shine in other planets? Again, any one of you can say.
You probably wouldn't be able to see it on planets that are further away from the sun than we are, because effectively we lie along the same line of sight as the sun with respect to that planet. Yes. So in those cases, we wouldn't be able to see the planet shine. If you could go around to the back of the planets, yes, you could. But
yeah. And thanks very much for the input, Ahan. I mean, it would be difficult seeing it from the Earth, but I'll just show you one of the very beautiful pictures which was taken by the Cassini spacecraft. These are moons, Rhea and Enceladus, shine in the reflected light from Saturn. So you can see the sunlight over here, and then you can see also the moons shining because of reflected light from the planet. And you can also see, you can see the bright crescents, but in the smaller moon Enceladus, you can also see an icy spray over here. Okay, the Rhea is larger than Enceladus. Rhea is about 1500 kilometers across, and Enceladus is about 500 kilometers across. But many of these moons are also active, and that is how you see this spray coming out. And this image appears sort of brighter in the center. That is because of the diffuse E-ring associated with Saturn. But these bands which you see are not real. These are due to the electronics or the spacecraft electronics over there. So you can see that the moon, the Earth, and the sun, besides eclipses, besides seasons, Earth shine is another important aspect about three components of the solar system that are more intimately related to us, that are closest to us, and where we relate not only our understanding, but also many of the sort of myths and legends and poems based on these three nearby. So now, if you were to look at broadly the constituents of the solar system, it's indeed a complex system of worlds. And this period, the last few decades or so, have been really the golden era of planetary astronomy, because there have been many missions to explore the different planets. Every planet we have actually either landed or there has been a flyby by a spacecraft. And I think Mansi and Kamakshi mentioned about the Voyager 1, which has gone into interstellar space. And there are several dwarf planets. There are hundreds of moons. Of the eight major planets, six were known to the ancients: Earth, Mercury, Venus, Mars, Jupiter, and Saturn. And as I just mentioned, there are hundreds of moons. We will just have a look at the number, and there are countless smaller objects, asteroids, comets. And to understand the solar system in some detail, one needs to understand the geological, physical, and chemical history of the different kinds of objects. And also we need to understand the origin and evolution of our solar system. We saw how from meteorites, one arrived at ages of about 4.5 billion years old for the age of the solar system by radioactive dating. And we also need to understand how does it relate to other planetary systems. Now, besides these six planets which were known to the ancients, Uranus, Hipparchus would have seen it, because Uranus's apparent magnitude varies between about 5.38 and 6.03. And when we learned about magnitudes, we noted that magnitudes of Hipparchus assigned from 1 to 6. 6 was the faintest and 1 was the brightest. And so it had been visible to Hipparchus, but it was not recognized as a planet. Being so far away, it could have moved very little. And it was discovered later by Herschel in 1780s, and Herschel too, he recognized that it was not a star, but he thought it was a comet. And initially he reported it as a comet. And in fact, when he wrote to the Astronomer Royal of the time, Neville Maskelyne, Maskelyne wrote back, said likely to be a planet rather than a comet, because it had no coma or tail. We know that comets have pretty prominent tails. The prominence depends on how close it gets to the sun and the nature of the comet. But later, Herschel also recognized. And Neptune was discovered, initially it was theoretically predicted by two astronomers, and somewhat working independently. One was Le Verrier in Paris and John Adams in Cambridge. In fact, it was using Le Verrier's calculations that Johann Gottfried Galle in 1846 made observations with the Berlin Observatory and discovered the planet Neptune. So you can see that Neptune was discovered both from combination of theoretical predictions and then observations with the made with the Berlin Observatory. So it's a combination of the work of three of them. In fact, Leverrier's work was reported earlier, and it was then that the astronomer royal of the time, George Airy, he said that he made the point that John Adams in England had also worked it out independently. And but a Copley medal was given to Leverrier initially in 1846, I think, and then without any mention of John Adams. I think they were trying to recognize his contribution that was made earlier, but John Adams was also given the Copley medal of the Royal Society a couple of years later. So we will have first have a look at the constituents, not in any great depth, but at least to introduce you to the subject and whet your appetite to read up more. So as I said, planetary astronomy has seen a golden era, and it is the only area of astronomy where we have visited the objects. All other kinds of objects is something which we observe, as we saw by electromagnetic radiation or neutrinos or cosmic rays coming from the distant reaches of space. But the planetary system is one where we actually have visited or went close by, landed spacecrafts, or landed, in the case of the moon, landed human beings as well. And let's just look at the overall properties of it. Now, you all know that the sun contributes most of the mass of the planetary system. Over 99% of the mass of the planetary system is in the sun. Jupiter, the most massive of the planets, contributes about 0.1%. And other planets, the remaining planets, plus the dwarf planets, we'll come to the definitions of that in a short while, only about 0.04%. The moons and the rings around some of the planets contribute very little. Comets, there's a huge range because we don't really know how many comets there are. Many of them, as we've just seen a short while, probably reside in the Oort cloud, which is the most distant, cold, icy region. And we can only guess because we don't have very hard handles on to estimate the number of comets that may exist over there. And then, of course, the asteroids, okay? We'll also have a look at the asteroids. The major portion is the asteroid belt between Mars and Jupiter, but we'll soon see that asteroids occur in a far larger region of space than the asteroid belt itself. And then we have dust, okay, which I haven't written down over here. Dust permeates all of interstellar space, tiny grains, micron-sized grains of carbon silicates, etc. Okay, so sun contributes the bulk of the mass. So this is just a schematic diagram. It goes as far as the Kuiper belt over here, named after the Dutch astronomer Gerard Kuiper. And you can see that these figures are not to scale really. Distances are not to scale. Mercury, Venus, Earth, Mars, the inner planets, the asteroid belt, and then comes Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune. So these are the major planets which are shown, and some of the prominent moons are shown, okay? Some of the prominent moons are shown. These are the Galilean moons of Jupiter, Io, Europa, Ganymede, and Callisto, and some of the moons of Saturn, Uranus, and Triton, one of the larger moons, which is associated with Neptune, is also shown in this figure, okay? Now let's take a step further and look at the, again, briefly, have a look at the properties. We looked at the semi-major axis and the orbital period, and we saw how p squared upon a cubed would be unity following Kepler's laws of motion. Now you can see over here that Mercury and Venus are the only planets which don't have a moon associated with it. The Earth has the moon, and usually the moon associated with the Earth is spelled with a capital M. Other moons are spelled with a small m. Mars has two moons, and Jupiter in this list is 79. And I think if you look at an updated version of this website, this has gone up to 80. And if you add these all up, you'll find that there are over 200 moons, including our moon and the four Galilean moons of Jupiter. And as I mentioned, these were known from prehistory, and Uranus, actually there were sightings of Uranus and Neptune, as I mentioned earlier, but the observations of Herschel really sort of made one recognize that it was a planet, and that is why Herschel is credited with it. But as an object in the sky, it was noted earlier. And although it says Adams and Le Verrier, you'll find that different people get credited depending upon their, you know, own preferences or national affiliations or whatever. But observationally, it was discovered by Johann Galle at the Berlin Observatory, and used the calculations of Le Verrier's calculations. Although, as I just mentioned, that John Adams had also done its calculations and predicted the existence of another planet, looking at the orbit of Uranus, which seems to have been disrupted by another planet. There are also planets with rings, right? So which are the planets with rings? Any one of you would like to suggest an answer? Which are the planets with rings?
Saturn,
Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune. Excellent, Kamakshi. So all the Jovian planets have rings. So these are the rings over here. Rings of the plane. Saturn is something which has been known since Galileo's time. The first time that one looked at these celestial objects with a telescope, and the ring of Saturn is largely made of water, ice, dusty rock. And you can see the ring mass, although it looks very prominent over here, it has a high reflectivity and it looks pretty bright, but the mass is extremely small. You can see the mass of Saturn is about 10 to the power of 26 kilograms, a few times that, whereas the mass of this is nearly 7 orders of magnitude smaller. And Jupiter's rings were discovered in 1979 by Voyager, mainly consists of dust. And again, you can see that the mass ranges rather weaker compared to the masses of Saturn. So I just put a range over here for the different rings over here. I put a mass range over here. And the planet mass, again, you can see is much, much heavier than that. Okay. There are four rings which are mainly identified, the halo over here, the main ring, and the gossamer rings, as they're called. Now, Uranus and Neptune, their rings are indeed very faint. And this was discovered in 1977, although in the normal literature, it is attributed to the Kuiper Airborne Observatory. It was also discovered almost simultaneously at the Indian Institute of Astrophysics in Bangalore. And the way it was discovered was that there was a star which was getting occulted by Uranus. And before it got actually occulted by Uranus, there were dips in the starlight, which can only be due to if there were sort of rings around Uranus. Okay. The Epsilon ring, which is one of the more prominent rings over here, has a mass of about 10 to the power of 16 kilograms. And again, you can see that the ring is a very small fraction of the mass of the planet. It consists of water, ice, organics, dust. And the last planet which we have among the Jovian planets is Neptune over here, which is organic and dust. And again, the mass is very small. You can see it's a very tiny fraction of the mass of the planet. So the question is, why do Jovian planets have rings? How do these form? And actually that is an issue which is not completely settled as yet. Initially people thought they may have formed right at the beginning when the planet formed, but it appears that they may form more recently, not only from the reflectivity of the particles, in the models that they have made, it appears that that they are more recent formations than the formation of the planets itself. And one current idea which seems to be popular is that they form from dust created in impacts on the moons orbiting these planets. They don't appear to be leftovers from planet formation, and they seem to be continuous replacement of tiny particles. So this dust really consists of tiny to sort of pebble size, some somewhat larger rocks, dust, etc., and ices as well, as we saw, because these are extremely cold regions. And the fact that the moons are likely to play an important role is that all the Jovian moon planets have many moons. We just saw the Jupiter with 80 moons. So there are multiple moons in these Jovian planets. And also we saw that Saturn's moon of actually spewing material, but the belief is that, or the current favored model is that These have been, you know, hit by impacts, and the dust and debris go on to form the planetary rings around the Jovian planets. Now, before going further, I just want to draw your attention to, this is just a phenomenological relation which was put forward by two German astronomers, Johann Titius and Johann Bode. What they noticed was that there seemed to be some periodicity in the location of the planets relative to the sun, from the sun. Now, it's just an empirical relationship. Okay, if you begin with the numbers 0, 3, 6, 12, 24, 48, 96, 192, 384, doubling the numbers every time, okay, doubling the numbers, and then you add 4 to it, and you'll get 4, 7, 10, 16, etc. till 388, and then you divide by 10, okay? Then you get 0.4, 0.71, 1.6, 2.8, 5.2, 10, 19.6, 38.3. And then you can see that, you know, when you look at these numbers, they're extremely close to the distance in astronomical units from the sun, okay? So this is what is known as the, it is more often referred to as the Titius-Bode law, or I call it a rule because it's not really a law actually, in the sense that we talk of laws in physics. And there is a close resemblance to it till about Uranus, okay? Now you can see how close they are to it. And it has had its sort of uses because when they made this law, Sirius was not known, the asteroid that we saw in the asteroid belt. And this law actually predicted there should be something there. And this asteroid belt was perhaps a planet which didn't quite make it to becoming a planet. And you see a whole lot of rock and debris over there. Now, if you look at till about Uranus, we are sort of okay. But when it comes to Neptune, okay, Neptune, it doesn't really sort of agree. This is the Titius-Bode prediction in red, and this is the actual distance. And Pluto, which is now a dwarf planet, also is just way off the prediction. But till Uranus, it agreed quite well. There is no strong theoretical foundation for this law, but it is possible that, you know, in the formation of the system, due to the gravitational influences of the various bodies which form, there may have been resonances which put these planets in these particular sort of orbits. But there is no strong physical mathematical reason for it. Okay, just a summary, law led to predict the existence of another planet between Mars and Jupiter. And that is what we just saw, Ceres in the asteroid belt, and asteroid belt was later found. And Uranus fitted with the law when it was discovered, but Neptune was discovered in 1846, the position predicted by Adams. But as I just mentioned, there's the history of it. It's not always consistent with what different astronomers put on their slides to explain the deviation of Uranus from its predicted orbit. Pluto's orbit, when discovered in 1930, did not fit the relation. Pluto, as we just mentioned, is a dwarf planet. So it's just a curious interest of how, you know, astronomers try to find relationships, and this is sort of an interesting relationship which had its own interesting ramifications. Now we come to, having a look at the planets, we come to look at dwarf planets, okay? We look at a definition of a dwarf planet in a short while, but what do you think is a dwarf planet? Any one of you would like to mention what is a dwarf planet?
Something in size between a planet and an asteroid. So it's large enough to be spherical, but not large enough to clear its surroundings of asteroids.
Okay, no, thank you very much. Anybody else agrees, disagrees, or wants to add to what
Kino has said? Orbiting around a star, but I think there's some rules it's violating. For instance, Pluto's orbit crosses the orbits of Neptune, so that's one of the other reasons it's not considered a normal planet, it's considered a dwarf.
Okay, we'll see that in a short while. Okay. Aquino's definition by itself would be fine, but there is one thing which is missing, which is that it should not be orbiting another planet, right? because, for example, the moon is not a dwarf planet. So you have an object which has enough gravity to be spherical or close to spherical, and it has cleared its surroundings, but it is also not orbiting a planet. Okay. So these are the five dwarf planets which have been identified. Ceres, we discussed when we talked about estimating mass. It is in the asteroid belt. And these are Pluto, Haumea, Makemake, and Eris. They are at much larger distances, you can see. And you can also see that these dwarf planets can also have satellites around them. Okay? Dwarf planets can also have satellites around them. Okay. Now, these names actually come from different sources, but basically they are named after ancient gods or goddesses of different cultural groups. Ceres was actually found by Giuseppe Piazzi, who named Ceres after the Roman goddess of agriculture, but he also had Ferdinanda attached to it, and Ferdinanda was the royal king in Sicily at the time, Ferdinand III, I think it was. But there were others who objected to it, saying that you can't have the king of your land as a name of a planetary of a body in our planetary system. And with time, Ferdinand got dropped, and today it is Ceres. Okay, and Pluto was the Roman god of underworld. And that was actually, the name was suggested by an 11-year-old girl in England, suggested her grandfather who passed it on to Lowell Observatory, where it was discovered. And it is also, the first two are also the initials of Percival Lowell, the well-known astronomer. And Haumea actually comes from the Hawaiian goddess of childbirth. And you can see Hawaii, and it has two moons as well. And Makemake is a Polynesian name. And that is how it is pronounced. And it's the creator in the Polynesian civilizations. Okay. And so you can see that all these dwarf planets have their names from ancient gods and goddesses, which are part of the culture of ancient civilizations or ancient peoples. And astronomers have found ways of naming different features, for example, the moon, the craters of the moon, etc. These are just interesting to read sociologically as well, how astronomers have devised ways of naming different objects. Now, just to recap, this is the IAU definitions of it. A planet is a celestial body that is in orbit around the sun, has sufficient mass for its gravity to overcome rigid body forces, so it assumes a hydrostatic equilibrium, nearly round shape, and has cleared the neighborhood around its orbit. So dwarf planet, as a celestial body that is in orbit around the sun, it has sufficient mass for its self-gravity to become nearly round, but has not cleared the neighborhood around its orbit. Okay. For example, as we just saw, Ceres is a dwarf planet, but not a planet because it has not cleared its surroundings. And is not a satellite, okay? For example, the moon is round, but is a satellite of the Earth. And basically, and Plutoids are basically dwarf planets, which are not in the asteroid belt. It is beyond, is around Pluto or beyond it. So these ones, Pluto, Haumea, Makemake, and Eris, are called Plutoids, okay? Now, just to show you the orbits, which I think Kriti mentioned. So these are the orbits of the planets, and the dwarf planets are shown over here. So what you can see over here is that the orbits of the planets are roughly at the same sort of plane over here, right? Whereas you can see that Ceres is slightly tilted, but you can see that the Plutoids, or the more distant dwarf planets, including Pluto, they are inclined at larger and larger angles. They could be inclined at very large angles to the plane in which the planetary orbits lie, which is reasonably well defined. Okay, and that's what Kriti had just mentioned. Now, planets and dwarf planets, they tend to spin on their axis. Rotation direction generally similar to the direction of rotation, except Venus, which has a very slow retrograde motion. Okay, Venus, in fact, rotates once in about 243 days. And so it rotates backwards. Uranus and Pluto have spinning axis nearly tipped to the side. And I think the spin axes of Eris, Haumea, and Makemake have not yet been determined, but I look for it, but that was, if any of you can find the spin axis of Eris, Haumea, and Makemake, do share it with the rest of the class later. Now, Mercury, Venus, Earth, and Mars are referred to as the inner or the terrestrial planets. They consist primarily of rock and metal, whereas Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune, the Jovian order, giant planets consist of lighter ices, liquids, gases. There is no hard surface on which to land. So it's like oceans with small, dense cores over there. Although they're often called giant gas planets, actually a lot of it is liquid, is in liquid form. Even hydrogen, which is under such intense pressure that it is in liquid form rather than in solid, rather than in gaseous form. Okay. Now, in the case of Mercury, Venus, Earth, and Mars, as we just said, consist primarily of rock and metal. And the most common rocks are silicates, silicon, oxygen, iron. And the most common metal is iron. And you'll find that the heavier metals have sunk to the bottom. So this is a differentiation which one sees not only in Earth, but in some of the bigger asteroids as well, that you see differentiation where the heavier metals sink to the bottom and the lighter ones remain at the surface or closer to the surface. Jupiter and Saturn, composition very similar to our sun. So that is 75% of hydrogen, 25% of helium, and small amounts, these are rough numbers, so small amounts of cores of heavier metal, rock, ice, etc. And Uranus and Neptune, which are smaller in size, they have smaller atmospheres relative to the core compared to Jupiter and Saturn, and have cores of metal, rock, and ice. So you can see that there is a difference in composition between the planets which are close by and the planets which are further away. We'll try to have a look a little bit into that later today. You can see density of inner planets is higher. About a third consists of iron, nickel, iron, sulfur combinations. Two thirds are silicates. And we just said about differentiation on this in the case of the Earth, and that kind of differentiation you see in this nearby planets as well as some of the heavier asteroids. You also notice over here that Saturn has a density which is less than that of water, and the Jovian planets in a similar ballpark as that of the Sun, whereas Mercury, Venus, Earth, and Mars, they are heavier, and that is because of the metals which are formed, whereas these are lighter. I mean, they have largely hydrogen and helium, as you saw, and that is why their densities are in a similar ballpark to that of the Sun. Just to reiterate that over here for the heavier, for the Jovian planets, gas is hydrogen over here, gas is helium, and then there is ice, not just water ice, but methane and ammonia, and then there is rock, which is magnesium, iron, and silicate. So the cores possibly original ice and rocky bodies. So this is ice and rock over here. In fact, the entire Earth would be in a similar ballpark as just the core of Jupiter. And as we just said, that pressure changes, there's a little bit of gaseous atmosphere over here, but pressure changes hydrogen into a liquid form. And still below, actually, hydrogen behaves like a metal. It's so much under pressure that the free electrons are available, and it behaves like metallic hydrogen. So this is Jupiter and Saturn, and you can see Uranus and Neptune are smaller, and they have smaller atmospheres compared to Jupiter and Saturn. And ice and rock form the core of these planets. Now one can ask about the composition of the moons as well. The Earth's moon is like the terrestrial planets. Most moons are in the outer solar system, as we just saw, that Venus and Mercury do not have moons at all. Earth has our moon, and Mars, as you know, Phobos and Deimos, and the three and the bulk of the rest of the moons are in the Jovian planets, and the three largest moons are Ganymede and Callisto in the Jovian system, and Titan in the Saturnian system, and they half consist of frozen water and half of rocks and metals. Asteroids and comets and the smallest moons, they were perhaps not heated to their melting points. Some may be fragments of differentiated bodies, and some of the largest asteroids, such as Vesta, which is shown over here, Vesta actually nearly made it to the category of a dwarf planet. It just missed out, you know. I mean, it looks nearly spherical, right? But not just quite there. So this is what is referred to as, you know, smaller solar system bodies. It's also referred to as a minor planet. I mean, these definitions sometimes get used, although the International Astronomical Union has tried to sort of make things a bit more uniform in terms of the definitions and smaller solar system bodies. But it's an interesting question to ask, for example, how did our moon form? And how did the moons of the, you know, Jovian planets form? How did the moons of Mars form? And some may have been captured, but we'll see how the theories about how our moon may have formed as well. Okay. Now, how do we determine the structure of the Earth? We clearly can't dig deep enough. Whatever we dig is right in the crustal region, the surface over here. So the Earth is. To understand how the inner structure of the Earth is, one relies on these seismic waves. Okay, there are different kinds of waves, longitudinal and shear waves, and these waves can also change from one to the other. And by looking and understanding these propagation of these waves, that one tries to understand what the structure of the inner core could be. And there appears to be a solid inner core, a molten outer core, a solid mantle, lower mantle, upper mantle, and a crust. And these have been all sort of arrived at by looking at the waves which propagate through the Earth and reach us. Okay, as I just mentioned, there are two primary kind of waves. P waves, which are primarily longitudinal and compressional, velocity about 5 to 7 kilometers per second in the Earth's crust and greater than about 8 kilometers per second in the Earth's mantle and core. And the S waves, the shear or the secondary transverse waves, they do not travel in fluids. Okay. And you can see that over here as well, when you look at the previous figure, that the S waves will not get into the outer sort of core, which is liquid, but it can change forms, okay? Whereas the P waves could go right through, right? So by looking at these waves, one tries to infer the kind of structures that one has. And one has put seismometers on the moon as well to try and understand the interiors of the moon. And also, although there have been only a few of them, in fact, because the lunar missions landing missions have not occurred for some time, planetary scientists want more of these seismometers placed across the moon to try and understand the interiors far better and look at these waves. Moon, as I just mentioned, SCARP is where there has been a vertical shift in the geology of the region, and this is near the Apollo 17 landing site. And orbital photographs show the elevation. And we know that the moon is shrinking, and it is shrinking, and that leaves signatures on the surface as well. As the inner regions of the moon is cooling down, and there is no generation of heat over there, that moon is beginning to shrink. That gives rise to these kinds of cracks on the surface of the moon, which you see. And seismometers have been placed by a string of Apollo astronauts on the moon. And from these studies, we know that the moon is solid throughout. Okay. We have not been able to do similar studies with...
Can you clarify the moon is shrinking point?
It would not be shrinking inhomogeneously. I suppose the whole moon would be shrinking once it shrinks, because the interior is cooling down, so the entire moon should be shrinking rather than just a part of it. Okay.
Okay.
Now we just saw that most of the mass of the solar system is in the sun. But what do you think of the angular momentum of the solar system? We have the sun which is spinning on its axis. We have the planets which are spinning. We have the planets which are orbiting the sun. So one can calculate the angular momentum of the solar system. And what do you think dominates the angular momentum of the solar system?
The angular momentum of sun is the minimum. I mean, it's very less.
Okay. Abhishek, okay, thank you. And what do you think dominates the solar system, angular momentum? Okay, we'll look at that, all right? Now you can estimate the angular momentum of the sun. You can calculate the mean density, you know the mass, you know the period of the equator, you know the radius. So we can just apply, you know, MVR, mass, velocity at which it is moving, and the radius. So assuming that most of the mass is within 0.6 radius, okay, is much denser in the center than in the surface. So what I put over here is 4 tau pi r cubed. And you also find over here that I put the period over here, right? Velocity, put it in terms of the period and the radius r over here. And if you plug in these numbers, then you'll get about 2 into 10 to the power of 41 grams centimeters squared per second in CGS units. And actually heliocosmology, is a very detailed and very elaborate study of the sun's interior. And that actually will give you a much more precise value. But for our purposes, just this is adequate because we just want to investigate and have a brief look at where the angular momentum of the solar system lies. So you can see, you can calculate this for the Earth looking at the orbital period, because that would be larger given the distance over here than the spin values. And so you can see that this is much larger than the angular momentum of the sun. But what takes the cake are the Jovian planets. So you can see Jupiter over here, if you put in these numbers, you'll get 1.9 into 10 to the power of 50 grams centimeters squared per second. Saturn is a little smaller, right? Okay. And so this is just a summary of it, that the Mercury, Venus, Earth, and Mars, the four planets, and the angular momentum is given over here in CGS units. Mercury is the least over here. Venus, Earth, and Mars is of the order of 10 to the power of 47. And we just saw that the sun is only about 10 to the power of 41. And as Abhishek correctly pointed out, sun would be very low. And you can see that the highest component is from Jupiter, but the Jovian planets are all in the range of 10 to the power of 49 to 10 to the power of 50. And Pluto is about 10 to the power of 45, which is similar to that of Mercury. And this contains about 99.2% of the angular momentum of the solar system. So while the mass is dominated by the sun, the angular momentum is dominated by the Jovian planets, okay? Now, just a few quick definitions. Now, look at the small bodies over here. Now, we talked about the IAU definition of dwarf planets and planets, and they try to coin the term of small solar system bodies. All other objects, except satellites orbiting the sun, shall be referred to collectively as small solar system bodies. So these currently include most of the solar system asteroids, most trans-Neptunian objects called TNOs, comets, and other small bodies. But phrases like minor planets and all that continue to be used in the literature. Now, just for a moment, just look at this ellipse over here. You don't need to look at too much of the equations over here. This is the semi-major axis. Q is the distance from the focus to the near distance over here. And capital Q is a distance from this focus to the larger distance over here. So that small q plus capital Q divided by 2 would give you the semi-major axis, okay? Now that's all I want you to note right now, because we just talk about distances of the different bodies over here. But before we do that, just a word on periapsis and apoapsis. Periapsis for a two-body system is a distance of closest approach, okay, and furthest approach. But when it comes to something going around the Earth, you use perigee and apogee, and G comes from the Greek word for Earth. For the Sun, helios, so perihelion and aphelion. And when it comes to Jupiter, perijove and apojove. And when it comes to normal star, periastron and apastron. Okay. So this is just something for you to be familiar with. Now, among the small solar system bodies, asteroids is something which we have met again and again. And we talked about the asteroid belt between Mars and Jupiter, which consists of rocky bodies of all kinds of sizes. But in addition to that, there are also bodies which are closer than the orbit of Mars. And this orbit probably never coalesced to form planets. You know, this asteroid belt over here. Okay, and these grains can be less than a meter to, you know, micrometeoroids. They could be grain sized. And on the left, what I've shown over here is the equipotentials of the Earth and the Sun. Right, and these are referred to as the Lagrange points. And you can see L4 and L5 over here. And similarly, the other planets would also have regions of equipotentials. And you can see that asteroids, for example, which are called the Jovian Trojans over here, they are also in fixed locations relative to Jupiter and the Sun and move around the Sun as well. So in addition to these asteroid belts, you have other small solar system bodies as well, which go by different names. There's Hilda's over here, which is between within the orbit of Jupiter. But the bulk of it you can see is the asteroid belt over here. There are probably, you know, lakhs and lakhs of objects over here. Not all of them have been cataloged. A small fraction have been cataloged. This is just to give you the scale of different kinds of objects again, that this is what we just saw, Jupiter. And then we saw the Trojans, we saw Hilda's, we saw the asteroid belt. And just beyond that, beyond Uranus and Neptune, is what is known as a Kuiper belt. Okay, Kuiper belt, and that is also contains lot of solid bodies. And in addition to that, there is something called a scattered disk, which has not been shown over here, and that is extends much beyond the Kuiper belt over here. The Kuiper belt is probably about 30 astronomical units to about 50 astronomical units. This is named after the Dutch astronomer Gerard Kuiper, although he was not the one who discovered this Kuiper belt. And but a scattered disk extends beyond that. And it is believed that most of the periodic comets probably originate in this scattered disk. And these objects, some of them could be rocks, but some of them could consist of a mixture of ices, methane, water, nitrogen ices. And Sedna is one of the objects which is beyond Neptune, which are also called trans-Neptunian objects, TNOs, which is believed to be largely a mixture of methane, water, and nitrogen ices. So you can see that our solar system has a wide spectrum of bodies beyond what we had talked about. And these small bodies, this I will not spend too much of detail, but just to illustrate to you that what is green is gives a location of these small bodies, asteroids. And depending on their location, they have been classified into different categories. You can see that Atira is entirely within the Earth's orbit. This is Mercury, this is Venus over here. Whereas depending upon those small and capital values of Q, they are categorized into different areas. MR is the ones which are asteroids crossing Mars, for example. Okay, and so these are just different names for different kinds of asteroids depending on the regions in which they lie. Okay. And this is just a summary which I've taken from this website over here, which again gives you the different values of small q and capital U and the semi-minor axis for the different kinds of asteroids, which is illustrated to you, as well as the Trojans, which we met a little while earlier. Okay. And as I mentioned a little while earlier, beyond the Kuiper belt and the scattered disk rise what is called a Oort cloud. And Oort cloud are believed to be the origins of lots of the, believed to contain lots of these comets. It's icy cold over there, and it goes on to about maybe 100,000 astronomical units. Okay, it was hypothesized by the Dutch astronomer Jan Oort, and it is believed to be a storehouse comprising of not just millions, but perhaps billions of comets. Okay, and we also know from comets that some of the comets actually disappear as well, right? Or they crash into planets. For example, comet Shoemaker-Levy crashed into Jupiter, as you know. So these are some of the main constituents of the solar system. We have already discussed about comets made of frozen gases such as water, carbon dioxide, carbon monoxide, dust, asteroids, remnants of the solar system form in distant polar regions, and also a lot of dust, you know, dust grains which permeate the entire solar system, permeates the universe as such. Okay, and that these are the important components of the solar system. But there's one component which I have not mentioned so far. So would any of you like to suggest what I may have forgotten or what I have not mentioned till now? It's a physical quantity which you're aware of, which you know very well. Okay. It's a magnetic field, all right? It's a magnetic field, not only within our solar system, but also pervades interstellar space, right? Now, this is a picture of the heliosphere, okay? And a few terms are mentioned over here. This is the heliosphere, this is the heliopause, this is the heliosheet, this is the termination shock. And right in the center, what you see is our solar system. So what is a heliosphere? Heliosphere is basically a solar wind bubble, okay, created by the solar wind and extends far beyond the planets. Far beyond the planets. You can see that over here, it has a boundary because this is the way the sun is moving and it interacts with the interstellar gas, that is interstellar space that it interacts with. Okay. Now, then you can ask yourself, what is a heliopause? The heliopause is the termination between the heliosphere and the interstellar space, interstellar gas that is present. And the termination shock, over which is marked over here, is that the solar wind actually varies, has a pretty high velocity, 300 to 700 kilometers per second. And particularly when there are coronal mass ejections and all that, you can see ejections going off at velocities even larger than that, maybe 1,000 kilometers per second or so, sometimes even larger. But at the termination shock, the solar wind really slows down because of interaction with the external environment. So that is where a shock front forms, and that is known as a transition shock over there. And right in the outer region over here, you have what is called the bow shock. That is, as the heliosphere itself is plowing its way through interstellar space, this bow shock forms, okay? And you can see the interstellar medium flow over here. And an interstellar medium, interstellar gas is also threaded by the magnetic field, okay? Just as our sun has a magnetic field and which permeates our solar system, and also individual planets have their own, magnetic fields associated with it. Now, you know about the Earth's magnetic field, which dominates over the interplanetary magnetic field. This was just discovered in 1958 by Explorer 1, and the direction in which it is moving towards the sun and you know, the solar wind is over here, then it is sort of is about 10 Earth radii or so, but in the opposite direction, it extends almost towards the moon. The magnetic field is strength is about 0.25 to 0.65 Gauss, which in SI units would be about 25,000 nanoteslas. Now, what about the moon? What do you think? Does the moon have a magnetic field?
You mentioned it still has a molten core earlier, and that's why it's cooling and therefore shrinking. So does that mean it has a magnetic field?
Okay. And you know, good thinking. Anybody else? See, to generate a magnetic field, you need molten material, which is moving, okay? Molten material, which is moving, liquid material, which is moving, currents will have to be generated to generate a magnetic field. With the moon, what happens is that there is no dipolar magnetic field, okay? Moon is shrinking, but it doesn't have to be always a liquid to shrink, okay? With the pressures on top, it could still be shrinking. And but there is evidence of magnetic field in the crust. Okay, and the crustal magnetic field is very weak. You can see in this chart over here that crustal magnetic field has been mapped reasonably extensively. It's about 100 nanoteslas or so. And for the Earth, you just saw that it is about 25,000 to 65,000 nanoteslas. So it is extremely weak crustal magnetic field. But the crustal magnetic field, the fact that it exists may have been, suggests that Moon was once did have a dynamo. But now it no longer operates. And that may have happened billions of years ago. Okay, so we do have a weak crustal magnetic field. What about the other planets? What about the rocky planets? Let's start off with. Any thoughts on that? Okay, let's see. Mercury does have a weak dipolar magnetic field. This was discovered by Mariner 10 in 1974, consistent with of a large metal core. At least part of the core must be liquid to generate a magnetic field that we see. But the field estimates are weak. It's about 1% of the Earth's magnetic field, about 300 nanoteslas. Mars has no global magnetic field. The areas of strong surface magnetization, this again, like the Moon, suggests a global field perhaps billions of years ago. Venus is not known to have a magnetic field, okay? But there is an induced magnetosphere due to its proximity to the Sun, formed by the Sun's magnetic field and a solar wind, right? But what do we have with the giant planets? The giant planets all have strong magnetic fields. Each of the giant planets has a strong magnetic field generated by a rapidly spinning interior. Planets' magnetospheres extend millions of kilometers into space. Charged particles accelerate in the magnetic field. And in fact, in the late 50s, synchrotron radiation was from Jupiter. And these radio bursts, which one sees from Jupiter, is something which is very popular among amateur radio astronomers to try and detect. Radio, in fact, right, recently Ferguson College, along with Iuka, has launched a competition to build a small antenna to detect bursts from Jupiter at low frequencies. These are emission processes which occur at low frequencies. And Io, one of Jupiter's moons, has volcanic eruptions and is constantly throwing charged particles into space. So you can see this is a sort of summary of the magnetic fields in our solar system. Okay. So you need fields to move, you need motion, a dynamo kind of action to generate the fields. And if you had an entirely solid core with no motion, you're not going to generate the field. But if you did have a solid core, then there could be remnants of the field present in the crustal areas, which you can detect, as we have seen in the Moon as well. What about the seasons? We know that the Earth has seasons, right? And what about seasons in other planets? Do you think they will have seasons? And
the ones with the tilt on the axis?
Excellent, Kriti. So the ones which are tilted on the axis, right? So just as we see the seasons because the Earth is tilted on the axis, Earth and Mars have seasons because the tilt axis are inclined, so does Saturn as well as Neptune, okay? But how fast it changes will depend upon, you know, its speed of rotation around the Sun. Jupiter inclined only about 3 degrees, so there are no seasons to speak of. So is the case with Venus and Mercury, okay? You can see Mercury is over here is axial tilt is just a, you know, small fraction of a degree. And the Earth is about 23 degrees. And where is Venus gone over here? Venus is over here is 2.7 degrees. And Jupiter is again about 3.1 degrees. So as Kriti mentioned, wherever you see a tilt, you'll see a season. But Uranus is the strangest of all because the axis tilt is very large. Okay, for most of them, you can see it's around, you know, 20 to 30 degrees or so. But Uranus is tilted at 98 degrees to the axis of the, to its axis. So let's see what happens to Uranus. Tilt almost 90 degrees with respect to north direction. So Uranus orbits on its side. So ring and the moon system follow it. It has an 84-year orbital period. So poles alternate between 42 years of sunlight and 42 years of darkness. So you do have seasons, but indeed very strange seasons. You'll have to, if life was possible like ours, if we lived over there, we'd probably just see, you know, one cycle of seasons. if you're lucky enough. So this is the Voyager, you know, just I thought I would just show you this because this is a spacecraft which was mentioned by Mansi and Kamakshi in their talk on interstellar medium. And this is the furthest reaches that it has gone. And it's quite interesting to sort of look at their website because it gives you, you know, second by second update on where the spacecraft is, how far away it is. As you can see, I took this on November 5, 2021. And this was at 2 p.m. My time. And just to summarize, four inner planets, Mercury, Earth, Venus, Mars, four outer planets, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, Neptune, dwarf planets, Ceres, Pluto, Haumea, Makemake, and Eris, lots of small bodies, comets, meteorites, the heliosphere, and interplanetary dust, and then the Oort cloud, which is up to about 100,000 astronomical units and probably contains millions of billions of comets. Sun contains almost all the mass, planets nearly in the same plane. Planets' orbits are due to the central force of gravity, but why are orbits in the same plane? That we'll try to answer in the next class. Density, four inner planets have density of rock, four outer planets density of similar to that of a sun. So composition of the outer planets similar to the sun. And we also see in the next lecture, possible ideas of how this may have come about. We also want to understand how the chemistry has evolved. We will not get into any great detail, but we'll just skim the surface of it. How did the moon form? That is another aspect that we would just briefly address. And what were the initial conditions that led to the formation of the solar system? So these are aspects which we will take up in a very short while. But I also wanted to draw your attention to Imka Dipathar. She is a very well-known planetary scientist. And this is a YouTube video on what wonderful worlds exploring our solar system. It's worth listening to it. She is one of the leading planetary scientists, and she works largely in the radio region or extensively in the radio region. And her talks are extremely, you know, sort of illuminating and good to listen to.